Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Barrenjoey Road, written by Neil Mercer and Ruby Jones and read by Emma Cary. Dedication. In memory of Trudie Adams, 1959 to 1978. Prologue. 2 days in March, 1971. She sat in the near dark, feet on the concrete steps that curved down to Manly Beach. It was 2 in the morning and she was alone. The soft glow of the street lamps behind her, the sound of the ocean in front. The minutes passed. Eventually, she stood up. And at 3:30 on the morning of the 2nd of March 1971, Jane Hampshire walked the 5 minutes to Manly Police Station, an arched brick building on the north side of Sydney Harbour. She told the officers on duty that she had been sexually assaulted. "We know this much because the New South Wales Police Incident Report, reference number 023475, detailing Jane's case, has survived down through the decades. It's just 2 pages, but even now, 50 years later, it makes for confronting reading on 2 counts. First, the brutality of the attack. Second, the apparent indifference of the police working the graveyard shift that morning." 2 sentences from the official report sum up the attitude of the officers. At the time she was first interviewed by police at the Manly Police Station, she appeared upset and had been crying. But there were no visible marks of any violence on her body, and her clothing was not torn or dishevelled. The report concluded, "Because of the doubtful nature of the report, she was requested to return to her home." Which was what Jane did. She went back to her flat, which, it appears, was not far from the Manly beachfront and the police station itself. Courageously, however, she returned to the police station about noon the same day. But the detectives on duty appear to have been as unsympathetic and unconcerned with their job as their night shift colleagues. The incident report from that day makes it clear that Jane was very frightened, but then goes on to note that she had not screamed or called for help. And as far as the police were concerned, there was some further scepticism because during the alleged acts committed on her, she did not struggle to any degree, although, as she stated, the acts did cause her some pain. A policewoman who had viewed parts of her body saw no signs of violence. Perhaps not surprisingly, given the attitude of the police, Jane didn't want to make a formal statement, submit to a medical examination, or go to court in the event of suspects being charged. Detectives concluded, "Under these circumstances, the complaint could be considered one of a very doubtful nature." Which was how it was recorded on the incident report. Alongside the heading complaint, there are 2 boxes, one for rejected and the other for doubtful. There is no box for accepted or to be investigated further. Police dismissed 18-year-old Jane's report with apparently 0 investigation. No canvassing of residents, no interview with Jane's flatmate. None of the basics. Little wonder that so few women ever went to the police. Jane Hampshire was from Britain, and like many before and since, she had no doubt been attracted to Manly's famously laid-back lifestyle. Decades earlier, the ferry service had sought to tempt tourists and locals alike to make the short, scenic trip from the Sydney CBD across the harbour with the slogan, 7 miles from Sydney and 1,000 miles from Cary. Manly is just the first of many beautiful beaches that stretch some 30 kilometres to the north. Dee, Collaroy, Mona Vale, Newport, Bilgola and Avalon, with the peninsula ending at Palm Beach. Collectively, they make up Sydney's northern beaches. Whether Jane stayed in the Manly area, we simply don't know. It appears from the remaining records that police never spoke to her again, which, given what happened just a few days later, seems remarkable and devastating. Because 5 nights afterwards, on Sunday the 7th of March, a 14-year-old girl went with her parents to Collaroy Police Station, just a few kilometres to the north of Manly. Jackie Billings was interviewed by detectives and told them that the previous evening she and her 15-year-old friend Sarah Sharp had been hitchhiking near Warringah Mall Shopping Centre when they were abducted and raped. Her description of the attack was very similar to Jane Hampshire's. This time, the response was very different, possibly because, unlike Jane, Jackie had a relative in the New South Wales Police. The teenager was taken to Mona Vale Hospital for examination by a doctor. Some weeks later, Jackie went to a police station and was shown some photographs in an attempt to identify the attackers. She also took part in a lineup, but at which police station that took place is not known because the statement she made at the time was subsequently lost. In any event, she was unable to identify her attackers. It's not clear whether her friend was shown any photographs. Years later, Jackie just couldn't remember, but she did recall something. I remember that the driver had snaky type of eyes. Exactly what inquiries or investigations were launched is now unclear. But at this time at least, the police did something. With their approval, a television segment that focused on unsolved crimes aired a reenactment of the abductions and appealed for help from the public. But if information was forthcoming, it was not enough to bring the attackers to justice. Jane Hampshire was abducted and raped on the 1st of March. Jackie and Sarah on the 6th of March. With three women attacked within a week, you would think that New South Wales Police would prepare for the possibility of more assaults. But there were none, or at least no more women came forward to say they had been sexually assaulted in similar circumstances. As quickly as they'd started, the attacks appeared to stop. But those 2 days in 1971, the 1st of March and the 6th of March, mark the beginning of a 35-year saga involving at least two murders, possibly three, and 14 sexual assaults, unofficially many more, all of which to this day remain unsolved. And then there's the collateral damage, the grief, the addiction, the overdoses. Even some police would find themselves traumatised, in fear of their lives, and disillusioned, quitting the job they loved. When you put it all together, despite the best efforts of a handful of dedicated and determined detectives, it represents one of the greatest investigative failures in the history of the New South Wales Police. How on earth could it possibly happen? Part 1. Chapter 1. The Day of the Dance. The 24th of June 1978 had been much like any other Saturday for 18-year-old Trudie Adams. That morning, she was walking down her street, Central Road Avalon in Sydney's Northern Beaches, when her friend Gillian Dollery happened to be driving past and picked her up. Together, they headed to Palm Beach, a half-moon stretch of sand 5 kilometres north of Avalon, near the northernmost tip of the peninsula, where the Barrenjoey Lighthouse stands like a tall, white exclamation mark. Today, Palm Beach is the backdrop for daily fables of heroism and heartbreak in Australia's most popular soap opera, Home and Away. But in the 1970s, it was locals only, and the families and teenagers of Sydney's northern beaches had free rein over their little slice of paradise. Every bay along the peninsula more pristine than the next, the coves hemmed in by the endless blue of the Pacific on one side and the thick bushland of Ku-ring-gai Chase National Park on the other. The headland is called Barrenjoey Head, meaning little kangaroo. Its other moniker is the Insular Peninsula, referring to the way everyone knows everyone else and there's no reason to leave. Sitting on the sand that day with their frayed, sun-bleached hair and winter tans, Gillian and Trudie looked like so many other young women on the northern beaches. This was their turf, and without them even being aware of it, the tides of the Pacific Ocean provided the calming rhythm of their days. That morning, they were discussing plans for their coming trip to the Indonesian island of Bali, just over a month away. What they'd take, where they'd go, who they'd see. Trudie wanted adventure, and Bali was a good place to start. It had become a destination for a growing number of young Australians coming of age in the 70s, with its empty beaches and legendary surf. In some places, you might be the only person on the wave. It was cheap too, which suited Trudie, who had been broke since finishing high school the previous December. She'd been looking for part-time work while she studied at the local secretarial college. Luckily, her dad, Charles, better known as Edge, was a Qantas engineer. So Trudie's return flights to Bali would be virtually free. But she still needed cash for everything else. In a letter Trudie wrote that afternoon to her friend Narelle, who was studying in Canberra, Trudie mentioned that she'd taken the day off from college to get her passport photos and injections for the Bali trip. The letter, written in rounded, sloping hand, is peppered with exclamation marks and a mood of excitement. "Don't worry, I'll make it. Woo! I can't wait. Can you imagine when I land in Bali, step off the plane and see friends like Gillian and Annette, pieced out Bali groovers, waving from the fence?" Friends like Narelle and Gillian were hugely important to Trudie. They were all part of a close-knit group of Northern Beaches girls who spent their days on the sand and their evenings at dances and parties. Loyalties shifted, but Trudie always remained the leader, the glue that held them together, and most of the girls would describe her as their best friend. If there was a minor argument, Trudie would sort it out, reminding them what it was they liked about each other. It was a role that suited her, and in photographs, she's always smiling and usually in the centre of the picture. Trudie was smart too. In her final year at Barrenjoey High School, she'd finished in the top 25% in the state, despite the fact that she and her friends regularly skipped classes to hang out at the beach. It was difficult not to be tempted. Barrenjoey High was built close to Avalon Beach, and while you couldn't quite see the ocean from the classroom window, you could hear it calling. Science, maths, or the sand? It was hardly a tough choice. Once, when they were caught at the beach during school hours, a teacher had tried to humiliate them by forcing them to wait outside the principal's office, all still in their bikinis. It didn't work. The next week, the girls were straight back down there, enjoying the sun, the water, the endless horizon. On this Saturday night, like so many others, Trudie was planning to go to a dance with friends. In a letter to her friend Narelle, she wrote, "Tonight should be good. I'm going to Annette's for dinner and then going to a bop at Newport Surf Club, mind you, and I think even the Bilgola Bop Band is playing. Woo-ee! I'm going to dance to every bracket. And it's Steve Bryant's 21st tomorrow, which should be a blatant sick rage. I could easily fill another sheet of paper with boring crapping on bullshit, but I'll have mercy on you and stop. Drop a quick hello if you can so I know Canberra hasn't turned you into an ice block. Good luck in your exams. Love and kisses, Trudie." Trudie had arranged to meet up with her friends Debbie Jeffries and Annette Daly. The three girls had been friends for most of their lives. They'd grown up together, been to school together, had sleepovers at each other's houses, kept each other's secrets. Sometime around 8 p.m. that evening, the three girls arrived at the Newport Arms Hotel, a sprawling landmark pub on the peninsula. The joint was packed with locals, most in their teens and 20s, but plenty of underage drinkers as well. It was a big pub, so it was easy to get past security and sneak in. But the Newport Arms was just the heart starter. The girls had bigger plans. So when it closed a bit after 10 p.m, Trudie, Debbie and Annette got a lift with their friend Tim Holland in his mum's Valiant sedan. They drove to the Newport Surf Club, a large two-storey brick building on Newport Beach facing the Pacific Ocean, its car park ringed by Norfolk pines. But after pulling into the car park at about 10:30 p.m, the teenagers at first stayed inside the car. Trudie had been looking forward to the dance all day, but when they actually arrived, she wasn't so sure. She thought the Bilgola Bop Band, one of her favourites, was going to be playing, but they weren't. Bummer. It was Trudie who suggested that they do something else instead. Maybe they could drive into the city. She knew of a band playing in town that was much better than the one at the surf club, but that would be a 1 hour drive and another hour home again. In the end, they decided to stick with their original plan and pay the $2 to get into the Newport Surf Club. Inside the club, the band.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.